Saul was told to destroy everything from this country that was at war with Israel. He kept a lot of the possessions that were committed to idols. And by doing so, he disobeyed God's commands. And that in itself is a sin. And even though he wanted to put those idols, those products of the idols, towards sacrifice, the prophet made it known to Saul that obedience is better than sacrifice. And because of your mistake, you'll lose your kingdom to another man, that being a better man. And today we're going to talk about the introduction of this better man, and that is David himself. So we go in 1 Samuel chapter 16 from verse 1. And it's a conversation between God and Samuel. And it transpires into God telling David where to find his new king. And the Lord said to Samuel, "How long will you grieve over Saul, since I have rejected him from being king over Israel? Fill your horn of oil and go. I will send to you Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." And Samuel said, "How can I go? If Saul hears of this, he will kill me." And the Lord said, "Take a heifer with you, and say, 'I have come to sacrifice to the Lord.' And invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. And you shall anoint David, you shall anoint for me him who I declare to you." Samuel did what the Lord had commanded him, and he came to Bethlehem. And the elders of the city came to meet him trembling, and said, "Do you come in peace?" And Samuel said, "Peace. I have come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come with me to the sacrifice." And he consecrated Jesse and his sons and invited them to the sacrifice. When they came, he looked on Eliab and thought, "Surely the Lord's anointed one is before him." But the Lord said to Samuel, Do not look on his appearance or the height or his stature, because I have rejected him to be king. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, neither has the Lord chosen this one. Then Jesse made Shammah pass by. And he said, neither has the Lord chosen this one. And Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen these. Then Samuel said to Jesse, what the Lord said to Samuel only. Then Samuel said to Jesse, are all your sons here? And Jesse said, there remains yet the youngest, but behold, he is tending to the sheep. And Samuel said to Jesse, send him and get him, for we will not sit down till he comes here. And he sent him and brought him now. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. And Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David, who was the son of Jesse. From that day forward, he had the Spirit of the Lord. And Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. Amen.
Amen.
So, God tells Samuel that we have to go to Bethlehem to find this new king. Right? But Samuel has one concern. If Saul hears that Samuel was going to find the king to replace him, Saul will probably kill Samuel for this, because Saul is not himself anymore. He's not the man that we met originally. He's become very torn, and he will become even more torn as we read on. So, to kind of work with this, because Saul will know what Samuel's doing, where Samuel's going, and why Samuel's going to do a certain thing, Samuel is told by God to go to Bethlehem on the orders of making a sacrifice. And Samuel goes to Bethlehem, but when he sees the leaders of Bethlehem and the elders, they're worried to see Samuel. And this is because normally when a prophet comes to a city, they don't bring good news. Normally it's because the city is doing something wrong, and God has sent the prophet as a messenger to tell them, you're doing this wrong, fix your behavior or you'll be punished. So the elders say, do you come in peace, Samuel? Have you done anything wrong? And Samuel's like, don't worry, I'll come in peace. And I'm here to offer a sacrifice. And God told Samuel to invite the family of, you know, the father of David, was Jesse, to the sacrifice, and his sons. Because God told Samuel that among these sons there will be a king. Right? So after the sacrifice is done, Samuel goes to see Jesse and all his sons, and he has Jesse present his sons to Samuel one by one. Now, when we think of a king, I remember the first time we started this lesson, we thought about the qualities of a king. When you think about appearance, you think about someone that can win any fight. He's a big, strong man, right? So when Samuel saw Jesse's sons, they were all big and strong. Jesse had a boy, he was showing them this, he had seven boys, right? And they were all quite old. So he was showing them all these big, strong men, and Samuel was thinking, these men, among them, there must be a king. Surely they must be a king, because they exactly fit the criteria of what I'd see to be a king. But the voice of God came to Samuel and told him, despite their appearances, none of them are worthy to be the king of Israel. And that's because even though they fit the physical appearance, their hearts are not fit to be king. They don't have the mindset, they don't have the will of God, and they don't have the spirit that they need to be my servant. So after Samuel went through all these sons and assessed that none of them were fit to be king, Samuel asked Jesse, are these all of your sons? Because normally, back then, people would have plenty of children. It was very normal. People have very big families. And this is just an example of many. But Jesse said, I have one more, but he's in the fields tending to the sheep. He's a shepherd. And Samuel says, I'm not leaving until I see him, because this must be the one. And then Jesse's sons go to bring the final son, whose name is David. And David is brought before Samuel, and the voice of God speaks to Samuel and says, this is the king that I have chosen. Anoint him. And Samuel was told initially to bring a horn of oil with him, and to signify that someone is being chosen to be the king by God, he poured like a wooden horn full of oil over this person's head. And Samuel poured this horn of oil over David's head before his brothers and before his father, basically anointing him and claiming him to be the next king of Israel. You all understand? Yeah? Good, good. So now, we go to verse 14. And we keep going from this story. And this is about Saul. Verse 14. Now, the Spirit of the Lord departed from Saul, and a harmful spirit from the Lord tormented him. And Saul's servants said to him, "Behold now, a harmful spirit from God is tormenting you. Let our Lord now command your servants who are before you to seek out a man who is skillful in playing the lyre. When the harmful spirit from God is upon you, you play it and you will be well." So Saul said to his servants, "Provide for me a man who can play well, and bring him to me." One of the young men answered, "Behold, I have seen a son of Jesse, the Bethlehemite, who is skillful in playing, a man of valor, a man of war, prudent in speech, and a man of good presence. And the Lord is with him." Therefore Saul sent messengers to Jesse and said, "Send me David your son, who is with the sheep." And David took a donkey laden with bread and a skin of wine and a young goat and sent them by David with his son to Saul. And David came to Saul and entered his service. And Saul loved David greatly, and he became his armor bearer. And Saul sent to Jesse, saying, "Let David remain in my service, for he has found favor in my sight." And whenever the harmful spirit from God was upon Saul, David took the lyre and played it with his hand. So Saul was refreshed and was well, and the harmful spirit departed from him. So, whilst David was being anointed by Samuel, Saul was having a bit of trouble in his castle and in his kingdom. Saul was being tormented by his spirit and he couldn't sit still. He felt very aggressive and very unsettled all the time. And Saul's servants in the castle saw this and they were like, "We need to bring someone that can calm the king down. He's so aggressive all the time. This isn't what he's originally like." And one of the servants says, "I actually know a guy that I saw one time, and he's the son of Jesse. And he tends to the sheep, he's a shepherd, but he plays the lyre very well whilst he's tending to his sheep." Because one thing David did, he used to write songs. He used to write songs for God, because David loved God a lot. David loved God with his whole heart. So a lot of the time, while he was taking care of his sheep, he'd spend a lot of time writing songs and playing them with his instrument. And a lyre is like a string, so it's a bit like a harp, but it's so small, it's about this big. And you hold it like this, and you play the strings like that, right? So it's like a makeshift guitar, in a sense. And David was called by the servants to come to the kingdom and to the palace to try to see if he could fix what was going on with Saul and try to help him out. And because it was set by God for this to happen, the effect was almost immediate, right? Once David started playing the lyre, Saul felt that he was better. And as David came to visit Saul more frequently, as Saul started to be troubled, it started to go away. And Saul got along very well with David. And he loved David a lot, and he thought, "This guy, he should be in my service. He's a great servant, right? I want him to be in my kingdom service." And David became Saul's armor bearer. So whenever Saul would go to battle, before he goes to battle, there'd be someone that has a suit of his armor carrying him wherever he needs to go. And that person carrying him at the time was David. So we all know the story of David and Goliath. And I'll summarize it now, but I want to skip it because there's something else ahead of us. So the story of David and Goliath comes right after this. The enemies of the Israelites at this moment are the Philistines. They've come to press the Israelites again, which is a very, very normal occurrence for them. They're always fighting. So Saul's ready to go to battle, and he's brought all of the Israelites' forces, but they've been stopped this time. Normally they fight the Philistines and they go off for a bit, come back, fight the Philistines and go off for a bit. But this time the war is prolonging. And the problem is that there's a very, very giant man on the side of the Philistines. His name's Goliath of Gath. And Goliath proposed a challenge.
Right.
And because the Israelites were having so much trouble, they had to hear what this guy had to say for himself, his proposition. And the challenge was, you bring your champion, and that champion fights me. And if your champion beats me in a fight, we will be your slaves. We'll surrender from the war and be your slaves. But if I win, it's the other way around. And because Goliath wasn't just tall, but Goliath was muscular, he was strong, quite literally. Like, when you think about someone that's tall a lot of the time, they're normally quite skinny, someone very tall. Goliath was very much over 7 foot tall, when you think about his size. And these people today, they were very tall people, but they don't have that much muscle. Right? So Goliath was a freak of nature. He was a giant, and there were quite a lot of giants at the time. These giant people running around the Middle East that were just massive. Massive in muscle mass, as well as in stature. So, in a suit of armor and with a weapon, he's even more intimidating to look at. Right? So, none of the Israelites are ready to fight this guy. Because it has to be one person versus him. And back in the day, no one's even that big. No one sees themselves and thinks, I can take this guy out. But because David was in Saul's service at the time, and David's brothers also went to war, David came to the battlefield quite often. And he actually was conveniently at the battlefield at the time that Goliath made his proposition. So he heard about it. And to cut the story short, he took on the challenge, and with his faith and with the strength of God, he defeated Goliath in one swing of a slingshot to the head. And from there, everyone loves David. David becomes a name, right? And Saul was like, wow, I can't believe you've done this. You're amazing, right? And in 1 Samuel chapter 18 from verse 1, Saul decides, since you're such a great man of service, I want you to live in my palace now. You've become such a great asset to me. You're like a family to me. So in 1 Samuel chapter 18, verse 1, we'll do some reading. And this is where David makes his best friend, Jonathan. As soon as David had finished speaking to Saul, the soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David. And Jonathan loved David as his own soul. And Saul took him that day and would not let him return to his father's house. Then Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan gave David his clothes, and he gave him David his armor and even his sword and his bow and his belt. And David went out and was successful wherever Saul sent him. So that Saul set him over the men of war. And this was good in all the sights of the people, and also in the sight of Saul's servants. Amen.
Amen.
So, once David has been renowned as the boy who's defeated Goliath, and he's basically the golden boy now, Saul has taken him into his house, and David meets Jonathan, who's Saul's son. And they get along so well, they're basically practically brothers, like the best of brothers. And it was described that their souls were basically tied together. That's how close they were as brothers. And Jonathan loved David very dearly, and David loved Jonathan dearly. Right? So, because as a sign to show his appreciation for David, Jonathan gave David all his armor and all his swords and his weaponry. And this was because Jonathan also used to fight beforehand. Before David was taken up, Jonathan himself took on some Philistines and a little camp they had. Defeated them all with his own faith. And because Jonathan was a man of God, he knew that by faith he could accomplish anything he wanted. And by seeing what David did, it touched Jonathan's heart, and that's why they became such good friends. Because they understood each other very well, they understood how things work, especially in the Spirit of God. So, now David has gone out to war now. Saul sends him on all these missions, and he starts to work his way up the ranks. And David performs so well that Saul's like, you might as well be the general of the army of Israel. You can be the general, because you're doing everything that I need you to do. You're doing so well. Have a promotion. God's clearly blessed you. So David is set above all the other men in the army, and he's the commander now. And the people love David. The people of Israel love David because God is with David. Everything he does becomes a success. Right?
Mm-hmm.
But this is where the problem starts, when we get to verse 6. I'm reading in Jesus' name.
Yeah.
As they were coming home, when David returned from striking down the Philistines, the women came out of all the cities of Israel singing and dancing to meet King Saul, with tambourines, with songs of joy, with musical instruments. And the women sang to one another as they celebrated, saying, Saul has struck down his thousands, and David his 10,000. And Saul was very angry, and saying this displeased him, he said, they have ascribed to David 10,000, and to me they have ascribed thousands. And what more can he have but on the kingdom, but the kingdom itself? And Saul eyed David from that day on. And the next day a harmful spirit came from God that rushed upon Saul, and he raved within his house. While David was playing the lyre, as he did day by day, Saul had a spear in his hand. And Saul hurled the spear at David, for he thought, I'll pin David against the wall. But David dodged him twice. Now Saul was afraid of David because the Lord was with David, but he departed from Saul. So Saul removed David from his presence and made him commander of 1,000. And he went out and came in before the people. And David still had success, for the Lord was with him. And when Saul saw that he had great success, he stood in fearful awe of him. All Israel and Judah loved David, for he went out and came in before them. Amen.
Amen.
So, Saul was still struggling with his torment, and David was still there every day to try to help comfort him. And it became so bad due to one thing. When David was going out to battle with Saul, because he used to go out together, the king and his general, fought together, David performed so well that people used to sing, Saul has killed 1,000, but David has killed 10,000. They're basically saying David's even better than Saul, the king himself.
Mm-hmm.
And this used to make Saul so angry, because he started to get jealous of how well David was doing. He saw how David was performing in battle, and how everyone loved him, and it's as if he was the king himself. And Saul thought to himself, you have everything now. You might as well have the kingdom. But Saul wanted to hold on to his throne like this. He didn't want to give it away to anyone. Because he knew in the back of his head what Samuel said that day, because of his disobedience, he'll lose his kingdom. And Saul has practically already lost it to another man. David is right there. He has everything. It's as if he's the king. So Saul is holding on tight. But because everything's playing in the back of his head, he starts to get mad. His rage starts to fuel even more than it was before, when the spirit is to come inside his body and torment him. And as David was playing the lyre one day to him, Saul had a spear in his hand and started throwing it at David twice. But David dodged, and David went away from Saul to just leave him alone. Because obviously at that point, you can just assume that that spirit was bothering him so much that it caused him to do that. So David didn't take it personally. David had been dealing with this for a very long time. He'd been dealing with Saul for a few years now. So he knew him very well, and he knew his behavior. But Saul was scared of David. Saul was terrified of what David was becoming, because it's as if he was the king. And he was very scared of his eventual replacement. But in verse 17, Saul decides to trick David. Now he's trying to work his way into killing David in a more technical way. Because he doesn't want to give up his kingdom to another man, the best thing he can do is try to kill him. And this is how he tries to do it. Then Saul said to David, here is my eldest daughter, Merah. I will give her to you for a wife. Only be valiant for me and fight the Lord's battles. For Saul fall, let not my hand be against him, but let the hand of the Philistines be against him. And David said to Saul, Who am I, and who are my relatives? My father's clan in Israel, that I should be son-in-law to the king. But at the time when Merab, Saul's daughter, should be given to David, she was given to Adriel, the Maholathite, for a wife. Now Saul's daughter Michal loved David, and they told Saul, and the thing pleased him. Now Saul thought, Let me give Michal to David, that she may be a snare for him, that the hand of the Philistines may be against him. Therefore Saul said to David a second time, You shall now be my son-in-law. And Saul commanded his servants, Speak to David in private and say, Behold, the king is delighted, and all his servants are more lovely. Now then, become the king's son-in-law. And David, and Saul's servants spoke these words into the ears of David. And David said, Does it seem to you a little thing to become the king's son-in-law, since I am a poor man and have no reputation? And the servants of Saul told him thus, and so did David speak. Then Saul said, Thus shall you say to David, The king desires no bride price except 100 foreskins of the Philistines, that he may be avenged of the king's enemies. Now Saul thought to make David fall by the hands of the Philistines. And when his servants told David these words, it pleased David well to be the king's son-in-law. Before the time had expired, David arose and went with his men and killed 200 of the Philistines. And David brought their foreskins, which were given in full number, to the king, that he might become the king's son-in-law. And Saul gave him his daughter Michal for a wife. But when Saul saw that he knew the Lord was with David, and that Michal, Saul's daughter, loved him, Saul was even more afraid of David. So Saul was David's enemy continually. And the commanders of the Philistines came out to battle, and as often as they came out, David had more success than all the servants of Saul, so that his name was highly esteemed.
Amen.
Now, it starts to get a bit bizarre. So, Saul has a lot of daughters, and David was unmarried at the time. So, Saul had a plan to get David killed, but not by his hand, by the hands of the Philistines. Saul's plan was to get David killed in battle, so he didn't have to deal with any challenge to his throne. And his plan of doing this was to send David in battle by fighting as many Philistines as he could. Right? So Saul said to David, you can have my eldest daughter on the price that you give me 100 Philistine foreskins. So you need to basically kill 100 Philistines. The item of choice was a very odd request, but it was proof that he had killed these men, right? And David said, that's fine. But it turns out Saul's eldest daughter was already married. So Saul couldn't do that. So Saul moved on to his next daughter, Michal, who he knew that loved David a lot. And this also made Saul mad, right? That Saul's own daughter was in love with his enemy, practically. So Saul said to David, my daughter loves you very much. If you'd like to marry her, give me 100 parts of the Philistines. And David said, okay, it's an honor to be the king's son-in-law. And David was very humble about it. Even though at the time David was a man, a very well-known man, a very popular man, very widespread in the kingdom, he acted as if he was a poor man. And David was very far from poor even at this time, before he became the king of Israel. But David's humble, he humbled himself and followed Saul's instructions because he respected him as the king. Even though Saul hated David, David loved Saul because he never knew what Saul was trying to do to him. Right? So David went out and killed double the amount of Philistines that he was asked for because of how much he loved Saul and how much he was devoted to being his son-in-law. And when David had brought the proof, Saul can't really turn and say, I was joking, you can't marry my daughter. Saul had to give in and actually give his daughter to David as a wife. David got married. But because of David's ability to just perform this made Saul 10 times more scared of David than he was even already getting scared of David previously. And David became so well known because every time he defeated these commanders of Philistines so easily because God was with him. And everyone could see that God was with David, especially Saul. No one could see that David had God on his side more than Saul. And that was what made him so scared, because he knew that he had lost that God and was given him victory. And it was only a matter of time until he could no longer hold on to his throne, right? And we'll talk about how he tries to keep killing David until he eventually loses his throne, right? Do you guys have any questions? You want to understand? Can anyone go to Sunday school? Jesse, can you pray?